Hello, and welcome back to another episode of 8-Bit Keys. So recently, a fan of the channel named Alex called me up and offered to ship me this keyboard, which is an accessory for the Mattel Intellivision gaming console. And I thought, well, wouldn't that be interesting to try to make some music with that? So I'm like, sure, yeah, go ahead and ship that over. And I thought this device, since it is made by Mattel and it's specifically for the Intellivision, I thought, well, this would just plug right in to the game console, and then there would be like maybe some kind of cartridge that had some kind of musical software on it. Well, it turns out it doesn't work that way at all. So let's have a look at how it really works and see if maybe I can make some music out of this thing. This is the Intellivision Musical Synthesizer. It has 4 octaves or 48 keys, which isn't terrible. And as you can see, this is an official first party product from Mattel. However, take a look at this connector. It's 2 DB9 connectors, similar to the joysticks used by Atari, Commodore, or even the Intellivision itself. But where does this thing plug in? If you look at the console itself, you'll notice it only has a single DB9 connector for each controller. But they're much too far apart for this thing. So that's where this thing comes into play, the Intellivision Computer Adapter. I first became aware of this device recently when visiting the National Video Game Museum, and I also saw there was a similar device for the Atari 7800. So if you open up this cover, you'll see the connector that will match up with the musical keyboard. And the way this works is it slides into the side of the Intellivision. And not only do you need to power your Intellivision, but the ECS module also has its own power cord as well. And of course, it's primarily made to work with this computer keyboard. And this keyboard has that same funky connector. So I'll just plug that in here. Now, when I first powered on my Intellivision, I just got this black screen, and I actually thought something was wrong with the unit. But what I eventually figured out is that you have to insert a game cartridge. It doesn't even really matter which cartridge you use. I'll use Frogger here for an example. Now when I power it on, I get this screen saying the ECS is connected. Now, pressing any key on the controller will bring up this menu, and there are 3 choices. If I pick 2 for cartridge, it will start whatever's on the game cartridge, in this case, Frogger. And everything works pretty much like you'd expect. If I power cycle and choose 1 for basic, it'll take me to a basic screen, much like you'd expect from a vintage computer. And it uses a strange dialect of basic though. Some commands are abbreviated. For example, you type prin instead of print. And the keyboard is pretty terrible, not just because it's a chiclet keyboard, but also the location of many of the keys is irritating, such as the backspace, which is actually the left cursor key. And one thing that's interesting is that when it parses a line, it highlights the different parts of the code in different colors, which is kind of neat. So there we go, my incredible program. Interesting to note that when listening, it doesn't show the color codes. Anyway, here we go. Basic is pretty hard to do anything interesting on this platform. Also, the characters are huge, probably a result of the low resolution of the Intellivision's video chip. In fact, it appears you only get 20 columns by 12 rows, which is actually considerably less than a Commodore VIC-20. The ECS unit also has ports on the back to connect a cassette recorder, and that way you could load and save your basic programs to a cassette tape. Now, it's no terrible surprise that this unit was a terrible flop on the market. There's a fascinating history as to why Mattel produced it, and of course why it flopped. And maybe eventually I'll do an episode on that on my other channel, but for now, let's see if we can make some music. I'll reset it again, and this time select 3 for music. I can actually play music on the QWERTY keyboard here, but the notes are not in any particular order, so it's just about random what note you'll get. So yeah, that's pretty useless. So what I'll do now is unplug the QWERTY keyboard and attach the musical keyboard. Well, that works a little better. Yes, it's showing sharps on the screen here even though I'm not playing them, but I'll explain why in a minute. The first problem I noticed is this. Yeah, some of the keys just aren't making good contact anymore. I can probably fix that. Then I wanted to test the polyphony, and I wasn't surprised to see I could hold down 3 notes at once. But I actually discovered it could do 6 notes at once. Now, this really surprised me. You see, the Intellivision uses the General Instruments AY38910 sound chip. Now, I happen to know this chip pretty well since we've been using it in our prototypes for the Commander X16 up until recently. And so I knew those chips only had 3 voices. So then I discovered that the ECS unit contains an additional sound chip, giving it a total of 6 voices.
The only controls I can seem to find is that if you use buttons 1 and 3 on the controller, it'll transpose the entire keyboard by one half step, which is why you were seeing sharps earlier, because I'd been playing with that before recording. And if you use buttons 4 and 6, it will transpose by an entire octave. And that's pretty much it. I mean, that's the extent of the music making ability. There are no different instrument types to pick from, or ADSR, or rhythms, or anything. It turns out there was a cartridge made called Melody Blaster. It worked kind of like a modern day Guitar Hero, and I wasn't able to get a hold of the cartridge in time for the video, but here's a clip from Arcade Database which they said I could use, and this is about all the cartridge did. I mean, it really didn't allow you to create music or anything, it was mostly just learning to play whatever songs were built in.
Obviously, the AY3 chips are capable of considerably more advanced sound than what this software is giving us, but for some reason that's all Mattel seemed to think that we needed.
Now, I did find a homebrew ROM called Synthy, which allows the user to play some more complex sounds.
You will be able to hear that the amount of warbling.
But I wasn't able to figure out any way to get this to work on my machine in the amount of time I had available.
Before I can do any audio recording from this, there's two problems I've got to solve first. One problem is that the Intellivision itself doesn't have any sort of audio output. All it has is an RF output designed for you to tune your television to channel 3 or 4, and that's how you would normally watch your games and hear any sound that comes out of the system. Well, the only way I could use that would be to either try to record from the television itself or use some sort of RF demodulator, which I just really don't want to do. So I think the best thing to do is to go ahead and modify the Intellivision for composite video and direct audio. But before I do that, there's one other problem I need to tackle.
I'm going to go ahead and take the keyboard unit apart and see if I can clean the contacts inside. It's pretty easy to take apart as there are just a few Phillips screws on the bottom. And there we go, the top piece comes off and the keyboard mechanism is now accessible. The inside's pretty dirty, there are dust bunnies everywhere, and it's no surprise it isn't working well anymore. It looks like I'll need to remove this metal bar, and there's just a few screws holding that in. Okay, so how do we get these keys off? Well, it's not hard, you just need a screwdriver and bend these little clips back like this, and there you go, keys pop off. So, I have a significant number of the keys removed, but I'm actually a little bit at a loss to figure out where the conductivity takes place. I'm thinking maybe it's under this foam pad. Regardless, this board is really, really gross, so again, not surprised that it's not making good contact. Okay, I've removed all of the keys from the keyboard, and unfortunately I'm not going to be able to remove the PCB. The main reason is the way it's attached to the frame, where they've just essentially melted the plastics to hold it down, so I'll have to clean it in place. I'm going to peel up this foam and see if there are contacts underneath. Yep, there they are. This is a bizarre method of detecting key presses. The actual construction of the keyboard isn't really bad, I've seen much worse, but the contact system here is probably the cheapest, most horrible design I've come across so far. Well, I'm going to put this back down for now and rinse the keyboard off. I took all the parts outside and gave it a good spray to clear all of the dirt and dust bunnies out of there. I still don't know what to do about this foam situation. I'm going to try cleaning the board with deoxid and then scrubbing everything really well, but that only cleans the one side of the equation, and to be honest, I don't think this part is even the part that has failed. This is a mind-bogglingly dumb design. It appears to be three parts. You have a plastic strip with holes, and then some foam, and then some conductive paint or something on the foam. And I think for the moment, I'll just try putting this back down and seeing if there's any chance it will work. I have the top of the board and the foam dried pretty well, but there may still be residual water on the bottom side of the board, in which case it may take a few days for that to dry since I can't get to it. But I'll just attach a single octave of keys and see what happens. I also took the liberty of cleaning the keys since they were pretty gross as well. Okay, here we go. It sounds like DTMF tones for dialing an old telephone. I guess it thinks more than one key is being pressed down. I pulled the foam back off and decided the best way to deal with this would be to try to recreate a new foam pad. So the first step was to attempt to get all the old adhesive off the PCB. The next step was to see if I could separate the foam from this plastic spacer. Now this will save me some time if I don't have to try to manufacture one of these myself. Fortunately, I found that with some work I was able to get most of the foam off, but it was still covered with a small layer of the old foam. Now, here's what the original foam looks like without the plastic spacer. I'm pretty sure they just painted the conductive area right onto the foam. I can't feel any other material here. I wanted to see if I could clean up that spacer a bit more, so I went for the WD-40 and let it sit for a while. And then combining that with some alcohol, I was able to get most of the rest of the material to come off pretty easily. And here is the plastic spacer all by itself. It's barely recognizable. So this is how it goes down on the PCB, and eventually we'll have to put some new adhesive on this to hold it in place. But I have to find some suitable replacement foam. I started at Joann, as I thought they'd surely have something like this. I mean, they have every kind of craft thing in the world, but all I could really find was foam like this, which was much too limp and probably made for stuffing into blankets and stuff. Of course, they did have some other kinds of foam, but this stuff was way too thick. So my next stop was Hobby Lobby. I mean, surely they would have something, right? I mean, they do have a variety of things made from foam, but not really the sort I'm looking for. I suppose if you need a pair of balls, they do keep those in stock. The next stop was the Home Depot. You know, this is really so typical. People always wonder why it takes me so long to make videos. Well, it seems like nothing ever goes right or goes as planned, and I'm always trying to solve problems like this. Hey, it looks like they sell three-dimensional icons for VLC player. So I did find some various types of foam here in the store, but I didn't think any of these would likely work. It really just seemed too thin. However, this foam double-sided tape caught my eye. I don't really need the double-sided part of it, but it does solve the problem of having to use adhesive, at least on this part.
Okay, so here's some of the stuff that I bought, and I'm just going to have to try several of these and see how they work. So here's one type of foam that I actually managed to find from a friend, and this is something I found around the house, just some packing foam. It's probably not going to work. And then this is the double-sided tape that I bought at the hardware store. And then, of course, I have to figure out how to make little bits of it conductive. So one possibility is I've got this copper tape here, which will be used. I've also got some Mylar that's conductive on one side and not conductive on the other, I think. So I might be able to punch out little circles of that. And I've also got some conductive paint that I can actually try painting onto the foam itself, which is kind of how the original product was designed. So I'm not going to give you all the details on this. I'm going to experiment for here a bit, and I'll get back to you and see what I found.
Of the many experiments I did off camera, the most promising one was to use the aluminum coated Mylar in combination with the foam tape. I tested it with my fingers first, and as you can see, it works. Of course, I can't use one long strip of the stuff because that would interfere with being able to play multiple notes at once. So I used this punch to punch out some little circles of the Mylar.
Alright, so I have cut myself out some of these little guys. I got about 50 of them here. And one problem with these is that they're only conductive on one side because they're Mylar coated. So I'm going to have to test each individual one with a multimeter to figure out which side to put them on. But anyway, hopefully these will work.
Next, I unrolled a sufficiently long piece of the foam tape, and here's the tricky part. I need to be able to mark where the circles go, so I'm going to very lightly place the plastic spacer onto the sticky part of the tape, but hopefully not get it stuck permanently. And then I'm going to use a Sharpie to mark the little circles. And then, I'll remove the spacer before it gets too comfortable being stuck there. The next step is to test a little circle here and see if the side is conductive. And no, it isn't. So I'll flip it over like this, and now I'll test it again. Bingo! This is the side we need. So I tried to place these on the tape by hand, but I found my fingers were just too big, so I ended up doing it with tweezers like this. And here's all 48 little circles now in place. And just to be on the safe side, I'll go back and test each pad to make sure the conductive side is facing the right direction. Unfortunately, as you can see, I did find one that somehow got put on backwards. I was concerned if I would be able to get this thing back off without damaging the tape or foam. Fortunately, I did manage to remove it, and obviously replaced it with another one. The next part is very delicate. I got my wife to hold up one end of the strip so that I could carefully line the spacer up as I worked my way down the line. The circles don't line up exactly, and I didn't figure they would. In fact, they're slightly larger than the holes in the spacer, which is why I needed to put them down on the foam in the first place, like I did. Okay, time for a test. Right now, this pad is not sticky in any way on the bottom, so I can just slide it under this one key I've placed back on the keyboard so I can see how it works. And it seems to work. I'll give you a little close-up here so you can see exactly what is happening. Since it looks like this is going to work, I will need to put some new adhesive down, but this will also be tricky. Now, the way I've decided to do this is to mask off everything I can and use 3M spray adhesive. Of course, I definitely have to make sure to cover up these conductive points, otherwise the adhesive will ruin the whole thing. So the idea is we just want adhesive between these spots. So I've got everything masked off, and this will give you an idea of where the adhesive is going to go. And then here's the 3M spray I'm going to use. I'll only get one shot at this, so here goes nothing. Okay, let's peel off this masking tape. Let's take a quick look at the adhesive. It appears to be exactly where it needs to be, right between the pads. Okay, here's another thing I only get one shot at. I need to line this up just perfectly. Okay, so far so good. I'll just press it down. And of course now it's time to reattach the keys so I can see how it's going to work. The good news is, all 48 keys are working now. So, time to reassemble the keyboard. And I ran into another problem. When I reassembled the keyboard, I found that the case had a stopper that prevented the keys from going down far enough to actually engage the thin layer of foam I used. So to counteract that, I simply removed the little wax paper thing on the other side of the double-sided tape, and then added another layer of double-sided tape on top of that. Then reassembled it all again.
Alright, so I've got good news and I've got bad news. The good news is all the keys on the keyboard are now currently working. The bad news is they're probably a bit more stiff than they ought to be, as far as it takes a little bit too much pressure to push the keys down. And when I tested the foam on a single key, you know, that's one thing, but it's not quite the same thing as actually trying to play a tune. And so, obviously this could be fixed. All I would need to do is take it all back apart and then basically do the exact same hack I already did, only find some other foam that's a little bit less stiff. But guess what? I'm actually not going to do that. This was supposed to be a 5-day project, and here I think I'm at day 12 already. And plus, I had promised to modify the Intellivision to put the composite video mod. I've already got the little circuit here for that, as well as wire up direct audio so that I could record some kind of performance. But that would probably add another 4 or 5 days to this long overdue project. So I'm really just going to have to move on with this. So what I'll do is I'll probably do the composite mod on a different video, probably on my other channel, The 8-Bit Guy. So until then, I guess that about wraps it up for this episode. So as always, thanks for watching.